Hi, I'm Jane Buckner from the Benaroya Research Institute in Seattle, Washington. And today I'd like to tell you about our paper, Shared Recognition of Citrullinated Tenascin-C Peptides by TNB Cells in Rheumatoid Arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is an inflammatory disease of the joints. Both T and B cells are implicated in disease pathogenesis. Supporting evidence is that T and B cells are present in the infiltrates in the synovium of RA patients. CD4 T cells are implicated due to the strong association with HLA class II alleles, particularly shared epitope in RA. And autoantibodies, including rheumatoid factor and the more recently described ACPA antibodies, are present in 70 to 80% of rheumatoid arthritis patients. Further, there's a strong link between CD4 T cells and the presence of ACPA antibodies. HLA-DRB10401 is associated with ACPA in rheumatoid arthritis, as are other shared epitope alleles. And ACPA have high levels of somatic mutations, indicating T cell help involved in their maturation. Our group has had an ongoing interest in understanding whether citrulline-specific CD4 T cells are present in rheumatoid arthritis. And we've shown that they are increased in the peripheral blood of individuals with RA. The reason that we are quite interested in this is that citrullinated antigens, when they're processed and presented in the context of HLA class II, can drive T cell responses. Citrulline residues are known to assist in the binding of peptides to the shared epitope alleles, allowing a neoantigen to be presented. Additionally, some peptides that are citrullinated may be able to bind class II, but only interact with the T cell receptor when a citrulline is present. And in this study, we've identified a set of peptides that require two citrullinations, one for binding and one for T cell recognition. In this study, we focused our questions around tenascin-C. We're interested in tenascin-C as a potential autoantigen in rheumatoid arthritis because it's known to have fragments present in the blood and synovium of individuals. It's also known to drive inflammation in the joint and promote Th17 development in murine models of arthritis. And recently, it's been discovered that citrullinated TNC5 antibodies are present both prior to disease and in approximately 50% of individuals with rheumatoid arthritis. So our goals in this current project was to expand our understanding of citrulline tenascin-C as an autoantigen in RA. First, to define whether the citrulline tenascin-C epitopes presented by HLA-DRB10401. Determine the specificity, frequency, and phenotype of citrulline tenascin-C specific CD4 T cells in RA, both in the peripheral blood and synovial fluid. And finally, to assess whether these same epitopes are recognized by autoantibodies in the setting of RA. To do this, we applied a Tetramer-based epitope discovery and validation pipeline developed at BRI. This allows us first to identify citrulline tenascin-C peptides that bind to HLA-DRB10401, then determine these peptides are immunogenic, and finally visualize the citrulline tenascin-C specific T cells directly ex vivo in the blood using HLA class II tetramers. Using this approach, we were able to identify several peptides from tenascin-C that were immunogenic in the context of DRB10401. And notably, among these peptides, we identified peptides that required the citrulline to bind to class II, some peptides that were able to bind to class II with irrespective of citrullinization, but required the citrulline residue to be recognized by T cells in the periphery, and then a series of two peptides that required two citrulline residues, both for MHC binding and TCR contact, which is shown here on this slide. We next applied direct ex vivo tetramer staining to samples from the peripheral blood of patients with RA and compared them to HLA-matched healthy controls. We were able to demonstrate that there was increased frequency of T cells specific for citrullinated tenascin-C epitopes in RA patients, that these were predominantly of a Th2 and Th17 lineage. And among the peptides studied, the greatest frequency was seen to tenascin-C56. Additionally, when we examined synovial fluid using ELISpots, we saw a marked response to the tenascin-C peptides that we tested. And notably, this was a much greater response than in comparable known RA antigens, as shown in the right lower graph. We went on to next assess whether there were antibodies that recognized the same peptide epitopes we'd identified as T cell antigens. We first looked in peripheral blood, and we were able to replicate the TNC5 antibodies were present in 47% of the subjects we initially tested. And notably, we saw a very strong antibody response in the RA patients to TNC17 and 56, the two peptides that required two citrullines to bind and be recognized by T cells. In the synovial fluid, we also saw that TNC17 and 56 antibodies were present and actually higher in synovial fluid as compared to plasma from the same individuals. We went on to examine the antibody responses in a larger cohort of patients with rheumatoid arthritis, and we were able to confirm that antibodies to TNC17 and 56 were increased in rheumatoid arthritis, and that these were associated with high-risk HLA genotypes and individuals with a history of smoking. So, to close, I'd like to propose this model where citrullinated tenascin-C peptides are initially presented to T cells where they're activated, they're able to proliferate, also produce inflammatory cytokines, but that these T cells also then help autoreactive B cells and they expand. And then I think what's really interesting in this case is the ability of a single peptide to drive both an antibody response and a T cell response. And we believe that this may lead to an amplification loop that could promote the initiation and propagation of joint inflammation and rheumatoid arthritis. So I'd like to thank my colleagues who worked on this project, as well as the patients who contributed their samples, and of course our funding agencies. Thanks for listening.